Hello everyone. Good afternoon or early evening, and welcome to this week's SOAS Development Studies and Bloomsbury DTC seminar series. We are delighted this week to be joined by Kavitha Krishnan, who I'm sure requires no introduction to most of you, but I will do so anyway, and also by Alpa Shah from LSE. Kavitha Krishnan is an Indian Marxist feminist and communist activist. She is secretary of the All India Progressive Women's Association, which organises Indian women and has led many struggles of women, most notably struggles of women workers in rural and urban India. And she is a leader of the Communist Party of India, Marxist-Leninist. Kavitha has undoubtedly become one of the most influential voices on issues of women's rights, labour and social justice in India today, and her writing and speeches have been published across a wide range of media. Alpa Shah is Associate Professor Reader in the Department of Anthropology at the London School of Economics. She is the author of In the Shadows of the State, Indigenous Politics, Environmentalism and Insurgency in Jharkhand, India. She is currently working on a book about India's Maoist-inspired Naxalite revolutionary struggle, and she is also leading a research project on inequality and poverty in India, which looks at the plights of Dalits and Adivasis over two decades after liberalisation. So, without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Kavitha, who will speak. Then Alpa will come in and offer comments, and then we'll open the floor to the audience. Just to let you know, for those of you who'd like to tweet about the event, the hashtag is hashtag SOAS Dev Studies, D-E-V Studies, all one, or hashtag ESRC, who's one of our funders. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Kavitha.
Thank you so much, and it's a pleasure to be speaking here. So I'll start off right away telling you what I want to speak about today. I think that there are some very high profile, very visible state-led campaigns, especially by the current Indian government, but that are underway, that claim to be addressing the question of disempowerment of women. So they claim to be campaigns for women's empowerment, and they attract a lot of funding, including funding from international funding agencies. And I wanted to share with you how those of us in the feminist movement who have been addressing questions of Indian women's questions inside the Indian women's movement for so long, who have been organizing women's struggles in India for so long, how we contend with, how we see these campaigns, and what the relationship is between these campaigns and our movements, our campaigns. Because very often, even in the Indian media and so on, and of course even more widely where India is looked at, very often these campaigns are looked at as a good thing, you know. After all, they are, you know, India is such a backward country, women are so badly off in India. If an Indian government and an Indian prime minister are talking about women and girls' education and against sex selective abortion and so on, it must be a good thing. But I think it's worth looking a little closer at those campaigns and see what they mean. Because very often these campaigns look at some, you know, things like violence against women and sex selective abortion and low sex ratio and lack of education for women and domestic violence and so on. And they look at these issues as disparate issues at which they have to address and achieve some outcome, some better indicator, something like that. And I think that feminist movements, when they address, you know, even while they address all these issues, they, you know, their focus is on asserting, you know, women asserting their own autonomy in their own lives, at their workplace, in their society, and so on. More control over their own lives and their labor and their time and so on. So, the state-led campaigns, they're framed by a political economy that requires women's availability for social reproductive functions, and they also want a pliant labor force, and they are advertising India as a place where you can get, you know, cheap and good quality labor at a low cost and so on. And they are advertising the fact that it will be more docile labor and all of that. And so these state-led campaigns, the state itself, therefore, is quite hostile to the very idea of women's autonomy, which obviously won't remain confined in some spaces. It will naturally spill over to everything else, including control over their lives in every possible sphere, including work. So these campaigns, these state-led campaigns, even though they're partnering with international funding agencies that are using the rhetoric of women's autonomy, these campaigns, however, they define, you know, women's empowerment, and that's a popular term they use, but they use it in ways that reinforce and legitimize the patriarchal offensive against women's autonomy in many ways. And they also resonate with a whole lot of other political campaigns that are currently there in India that are very sharply almost defined in terms of their attack, their outright assault on women's autonomy in their lives. And so I'd like to specifically look today at two of the campaigns. One is the Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao campaign, that is the Save Girls and Save Your Daughters and Educate Daughters campaign. And the Swachh Bharat campaign, which is the Clean India campaign, which is a campaign for building more toilets and so on. And both these campaigns are very, very visible in India today. They're backed by the Prime Minister, by the government. And the Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao campaign gets funding from the USAID, and it partners with the USAID's Girl Rising campaign. And the Swachh Bharat campaign gets funding from the USAID and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. So I just wanted to begin by sharing with you some of the, to situate this discussion, because very often you tend to get a lot of numbers thrown at you when you talk about India and the women's situation there. So you'll get to know, so many rapes. You'll get to know, this is the sex ratio and so on. And just to situate those statistics and those facts and figures in a slightly different matrix, we could look at the data of the National Family Health Survey 2005, which is the latest National Family Health Survey data, as well as some of the findings of the Indian Human Development Survey 2012, which establish specifically how denial of autonomy itself is a form of violence and discrimination that Indian women face. And, it might seem like a no-brainer. It might seem like, why does this need to be said? But of course. But it's important for us to keep emphasizing this point, because, as I'm sure those of you who are at all familiar with India know, state policies often prescribe and impose restrictions on women's autonomy in the name of keeping them safe from violence. So it happens all the time. So to assert that even these restrictions are themselves a form of violence and they're a form of discrimination is therefore important. So I'll just, if you look at the Indian Human Development Survey 2012 finds that only 5% of women in India have sole control over choosing their own husbands. So over choosing their partners, over choosing what they will do with their personal lives, partner in life. And even something like choosing to visit a health center, you find that almost 80% of women need permission from sometimes more than one family member. So maybe their husband, maybe an older male family member or an older female family member to visit a health center. And freedom of movement, according to the National Family Health Survey, is curtailed quite severely for most women in India. So, just one third of women are able to go out alone to the market or to the health center or anywhere outside. So this mobility outside is itself something which asserting that right to mobility is itself, an important assertion. So, we know that because when we go to, if we go to hold a meeting of women in any part of India, anywhere in India, one of our concerns will be that to keep a women's organization or a trade union active, then those women would have to assert their right to come out of their homes, to hold meetings regularly, to go out, to be part of larger campaigns outside, and so on. So naturally, that becomes one of the primary areas of focus, no matter what you're organizing around, no matter what the immediate issue is around which you're organizing and around which there's a struggle. But this becomes part of what we do. And the National Family Health data shows that If you see the reasons that people give for why there's such a large acceptance for domestic violence, I mean, their data shows that there's a very large acceptance among both women and men for the idea that domestic violence is okay. So, and they find that even among educated men and women, although the acceptance level is less, but there's a very large number, quite a majority, that feels that for one reason or the other, domestic violence is justified. And the assumption, they found that the violence is more likely to be justified if the behavior of the women is seen as violating their, prescribed role as wives or mothers or daughters-in-law. So, they find that data from both women and men suggests that being a respectful daughter-in-law and properly looking after the house and children are sort of essential roles. And if you don't do those, if you're not doing that, then it's all right for domestic violence to happen. And you see a lot of that because you find that you can see, in all the reasons being given, so not cooking food properly and neglecting the house or children or showing disrespect for the in-laws and so on are all reasons which, they're part of the rationalizations for domestic violence. And you find, therefore, that... you've already seen that. So I wanted to make this point to underline the point that even where something like domestic violence is concerned, it's also not just the violence is there and the violence is held in place by an entire set of values, and even that is not only just culture or mindset. The culture also is part of something where women's labor, the expectation that women will perform these domestic services and this reproductive labor is part of what holds all that in place. And domestic violence is one of the ways in which women are, disciplined into doing that. And you find that even where rape statistics is concerned, as I've, in the data I've put up here, you find that there's a very high level of disguised violence there against women's autonomy, which often gets hidden because even in the Indian media, when people speak to us from the Indian media, they'll be talking about so many rapes a minute, so many rapes a day. And I never like to use those numbers anymore because I feel uneasy with them. I feel that they're actually, we're talking about something while we are managing to hide another kind of violence that we're not talking about, hidden in those same numbers. Because with this researcher in The Hindu called Rukmini S., she found she studied the cases of rape that came into Delhi courts for trial. And she found that almost 40% of those cases are actually cases of consensual elopements that parents have called rape, which means that the woman is not saying that I have been raped. But the police is quite happy to file the rape case there. And, we know what a struggle it is to file a rape case where the woman is saying, I have been raped. But where the parents are coming out there and saying, my daughter has been taken away by this boy or taken away by this man, then you find cases of rapes and abductions and so on being filed. So, this is a violence which is an open secret in a way. It's called rape. But it's actually quite another kind of violence, and it's an open secret, and even the police is complicit in it. And it enjoys, currently, for the past couple of years in India, with the current regime that we have at the center, it also enjoys political sanction and encouragement from sort of vigilante organizations that are very close to the ruling party at the center and that feel empowered to give a political shape to this violence, to actually go and disrupt interfaith or intercaste marriages and so on, and make a political issue of them. So feminist movements in India have noted that the police and state machinery is systematically complicit in what are called honor crimes, and that's not a term I'm very comfortable with, but I'm using it for wider understanding here. But it's like family custodial violence, basically, and this includes even the murders of couples who have loved across the boundaries of caste or against the diktats of caste groups and caste organizations or interfaith marriages or same-sex relationships and so on. All of those are at the receiving end of this kind of violence, and feminist movements have a running battle against this kind of violence. So basically, I just want to say here that this kind of violence is, as I said earlier, it's not just about culture and mindset, it's also about this violence against women's autonomy and against violations of gender roles. It helps maintain the caste system, and it helps maintain women's continued role in unpaid social reproductive work. And so even the state and the globalized market, they have an interest in maintaining this kind of these structures as well. They don't really have an interest in dismantling them at all, which is the backdrop in which we'll look at those campaigns a little more closely. So I'll start by looking at the Beti Bachao campaign. Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, that means save your daughter or protect your daughter and educate your daughter. So it seems pretty, it was a campaign aimed at, supposedly against sex selective abortion and for girls' education. And it's a campaign that's projected as a brainchild of the Prime Minister Modi himself. So he announced it in a speech of his, I think in an Independence Day speech. So in associated campaigns, he has personally spearheaded on social media and so on, campaigns as part of the Beti Bachao campaign, such as the Selfie with Daughter campaign, which means a campaign in which fathers especially, but parents generally, are encouraged to post selfies with their daughters. So that campaign also got a lot of media attention and all of that. Now, I wanted to look at where these campaigns really originated. So these slogans of Beti Bachao have various resonances, which I'll come to a little later. But I'll briefly mention that here, but we'll go back to that a little later. The Beti Bachao slogan actually predates this campaign. It's a slogan, save your daughter, protect your daughter, is a slogan specifically used by the Hindu right-wing groups, which are close to the ruling Bharatiya Janata Party now, Modi's party, the Prime Minister's party. And they used it specifically to foment anti-Muslim violence by saying that to Hindu parents, your daughters are in danger from Muslim men. So what are they in danger of? They're in danger, they say, of violation by Muslim men, violation of their honor. But that's a vague term, because what does it mean? Does it mean rape by Muslim men? Well, they, as we saw already, rape and consensual sexual relationships are, they become interchangeable even where cases are being filed, right? Yeah, so in the public mind and even in the thinking of the state machinery and so on. So they use this slogan quite deliberately to say that Muslim men are doing love jihad. Your daughter might fall in love with a Muslim and he is actually out there trying to seduce. Muslim men are out there trying to seduce Hindu women and then turn them into Muslims. So it's part of this demographic battle that Muslims are doing in India to change the numbers and, become the majority and so on and so forth. So it's part of that entire thing. So they would actually pick on, they picked specifically on specific instances where young women, Hindu girls and Muslim boys had run away or gotten married and all of that, and they tried to say it's love jihad. Not a single one of those cases actually, got sustained in any way, because even in instances where they had managed to coerce the woman into saying that she had been raped and so on, at some stage the girl, the young woman would escape from her family and the custody in which she'd been held and run away and go public and say that no, I actually have married this person and that's the person I want to live with. So this was, they didn't really succeed in terms of actually, managing to successfully criminalize any of these relationships. But they used the slogan nevertheless, and they continue to use it even in the ongoing Uttar Pradesh elections. Now you have the BJP, Modi's right hand man and the BJP president Amit Shah promising and the manifesto promises it to set up anti-Romeo squads. So so all the Juliets can worry because the Romeos will be punished, so they call it an anti-Romeo squad. So the Beti Bachao slogan has that provenance, that's where it comes from. So then when you find it in this campaign, you know, in this, you know, sort of unarguable campaign, how can you argue with a campaign that says, but what happens is that you're having this slogan on huge hoardings and in campaigns and in the prime minister's speeches and everywhere, it's surrounding you, right? And at the same time, it's also a campaign that's being used by the Hindu vigilante right-wing groups. So, you know, the way in which they resound together and the, you know, the it's a dog whistle that's continuously blowing, right, out there. So, you know, so that slogan, I just wanted to put that in place. Then the selfie with daughter campaign. If you look at where that originated, that's interesting because there is in a Haryana village called Bibipur, there was an organization called the Avivahit Purush Sangathan, the Unmarried Men's Union, and it's called the Unmarried Men's Union. And it's basically because the sex, you know, they said that the sex ratio is low, and that's why we are unmarried. And you know, it's actually a strange argument, right? Because basically they are saying that we are entitled to wives, and we are entitled to wives from the right caste and community. And because we are not getting them, because you know the government should do something about this, because they were quite serious about it. They gave the slogan "Get us brides if you want votes" and all of that. And so you know this whole question of sex selection and skewed sex ratio then is approached. It's not approached from the point of view of women's rights and their autonomy and their lives, but from the perspective of men's deprivation of entitlement to wives, right? So that's the way in which this whole thing was approached by that organization. And, you know, the idea was that men need wives to perform sexual and reproductive duties and household labor, which, as we saw, is a very widely accepted kind of idea. And if wives are in short supply in Haryana, they must be sourced and bought from, even bought from other states, which is happening. So this is the perspective that dominates in Haryana. And you had this BJP leader, I don't know if I have that up here, okay. You have this BJP leader, O.P. Dhankar. He is a farmers leader and prominent BJP leader there. He assured this farmers conference in Jind during the 2014 elections that Modi won, that making the BJP strong means that those youths in many villages who are roaming without brides will get one. And he promised that I'll get you really good quality brides from Bihar, because the Sushil Modi, who was then Deputy Chief Minister of Bihar, is a good friend of mine, and we'll do that for you. So you see, there was this acceptance that basically it's about the whole issue is being talked about in terms of fulfilling men's entitlement to wives, and this is the village in which this selfie with daughter campaign started. And that village, you know, it got identified as a model village, and it's a model panchayat, it's a model village, and it got, you know, funding from the government and all of that, because it was doing this, it was saying that we are fighting sex selective abortion. And how was it doing that was something, when I read a more detailed report of what was going on in that village, I found it very disturbing, deeply disturbing, because one of the things that came out in reports from that village, you know, and quite, you know, positively worded reports and all of that, was that they are asking older women in the village to keep surveillance on pregnant women. So basically, you have to, you know, the idea is, as we've already seen from, you know, there is how much restriction there is on women's mobility, which means that there's women are already almost always under surveillance, in even as young girls and as young married women in their in-laws' house and all of that. And what this sarpanch was doing of this village, for instance, there's a 63-year-old woman called Sheila Devi, and she's part of a secret committee that this sarpanch, the head of the village, set up. And, you know, so she's part of the secret committee that keeps tabs on pregnant women. So, and then they'll keep telling those women that if you abort your baby, then that's murder. So it's kanya hatya, it's the murder of a girl, and it's a sin and all of that. So basically, those women will now be under pressure to produce sons,
and abort a female fetus, and also under pressure by being told that basically this is a murder of a daughter and all of that. And the idea that somehow women should have greater control over their own lives and their decisions is something that is lost in all of this. It's just more surveillance. It's more surveillance and more control over their lives rather than more control by, you know, older women and the entire panchayat keeping tabs on their lives, rather than the idea that maybe, you know, women actually having greater control in their own lives might make a difference. So you have the secret surveillance added to whatever or family surveillance is already happening. And it's not likely to be very effective what this Bibipur Panchayat was doing, because you did have studies by the Kurukshetra University Geography Department. I mean, they did go and do a study in the village, and they did found that the overall sex ratio there was not very good compared even to the rest of Haryana and so on. But my point is that even if it were, it's difficult. Sex ratio has to be calculated over a period of time. You can't really calculate it in small windows like that anyway. But the point is that, feminism is about, talking about women's inalienable right to their autonomy and equality and freedom from discrimination. And it's about breaking patriarchal restrictions. But paternalistic campaigns like this, basically, they set out to, they may loosen or reset the restrictions. They may reset the rules at some stage, but they're still, retaining the right to decide how much or how little to restrict women's freedoms. So they have, if you look at this panchayat as well as other panchayats in Haryana, you find that some of them, in Haryana, there's systematically a lot of violence against intercaste, and same gotra means within the same caste, but there are different gotras. So people belonging to the same gotra are considered to be brother and sister. That's the understanding. So if people within the same, and some, it can be a very large group. So if people within the same gotra decide to fall in love and get married, then they can, there have been many instances of them being killed at the behest of these kharp panchayats. The kharps are those that control, those community decision-making bodies, community bodies, basically. So these, but some of these bodies, they said, we don't want to be called Talibanic anymore, and we want to get this more modern image. So they started saying, we're going to fight sex-selective abortion. So they got a lot of pats on the back from the state government as well as the central government and all of that. But you find that they continue to ban intercaste marriages. One of them, for instance, one of these kharps in Satrol kharp of Hisar, they decided to allow intercaste marriages, but it was with a lot of caveats. And they said that we will continue to ban intercaste marriages in the same and bordering villages as well as same gotra marriages. So we won't allow those. And, the point is that you have the law in India, Special Marriages Act, says that, the adults can marry irrespective of caste or gotra. So the idea is that these community bodies are still retaining the right to, lay down these laws. And yet they're being lauded as being, model panchayats, and they're doing these historic things for women and all of that. And the same, in fact, this Bibipur Panchayat, they had a very well-publicized women's Sarva Kharp Panchayat, because the Kharp meetings actually, the meetings of the Kharps, the meetings of these community panchayats never have women in them. So the other aspect about them is that they are of these dominant castes. So the Dalits in the village, those of the oppressed castes in the village, they don't have any say there. So the Kharp can decide things about, ownership of land. It's supposed to be a dispute resolution mechanism. But disputes over land and so on, they would just decide them obviously in favor of the powerful people. If it's a dispute over property within a family, then it will obviously be with the man against the brother against the sister and so on. All these things. And you have in Haryana, so this village set out to say that we're going to hold this, and it got a lot of media attention because they said we're going to hold a women's kharp panchayat. So they called from various kharps all across Haryana, they hosted this women's sarva kharp panchayat. And it was all against what they call female feticide, which is sex-selective abortion. But that's a term used quite a lot in India, female feticide. So that was what they did. But some women's group activists there went to the panchayat and they said that they tried to speak in the panchayat and raise the issue that since 2005, India has a law that allows daughters to inherit ancestral property, including land. And that law, you have several panchayats in Haryana that have passed diktats against that law. They've demanded that law be changed. And they have actually passed orders saying, we will disinherit, we will excommunicate a family if they give land to a daughter and all of that. So when these women's rights activists, these feminist activists tried to raise it in that place, they were, shooed off from the stage and told, you can't do that here. And yet this is the panchayat that the Haryana government got gave 1 crore rupees to for its efforts against sex selective abortion. So, since then, the Haryana government has been claiming that because of the Beti Bachao campaign, that has turned around out. It has, they're claiming this dramatic turnaround in their sex ratio in the state. And they claim that since the Beti Bachao campaign is since 2014, right? So it's since the Modi government came to power. So they're claiming that the child sex ratio in the state has improved from 834 girls to every 1,000 in the 2011 census to 903 girls to 1,000 in December 2015. Now, a lot of observers and activists have pointed out that this is a very misleading claim, because sex ratio, for one thing, cannot be measured every day. And it's, it's not like pollution levels, right, that you can measure it, every day, right? It's something that is measured over time. And you have to track it. And the changes in the sex ratio become apparent only over a certain time. And the other thing is that if you look at, what is at bottom, what's the problem? Where is the sex ratio problem actually located? Is it only located in culture and tradition and mindset? You have a lot of evidence that it's not. That in fact, those communities, there were only some communities in India that used to do sex selection or believe in, son preference of that kind. It has spread in the past, 20 years or so. So it has actually, it's not some, culture and tradition that's ongoing forever and you're waiting for it to change. The change that you've seen in the past 20 years or so of liberalization and globalization has made sex selection and son preference almost ubiquitous across communities in India. And it has spread with the growth of technology, use of ultrasound technology for this purpose. And invariably, those who can afford ultrasound technology more easily, as in the richer, so you have more sex, you have a worse sex ratio in the cities among educated people, and so on and so forth. So clearly, this is not just about, backward, lack of education, and therefore sex selective abortion. That's not how it's going. So, what women's groups have strongly said right from the beginning, and they flagged this issue way back in the 1980s, was that you have to, this is about a medical industry that is actually profiting from, and, to begin with, they would openly advertise sex selection. Now it's been outlawed, but it's still an industry that is profiting out of sex selection and clearly, continuing to do it. So the law that bans it, and the law in India does not ban abortion. Women have a right to abortion. Women have a right to privacy during the pregnancy. What they do is that the sex determination by the doctor, which means the doctor is not supposed to tell the parents the sex of the fetus, which is why abortion remains legal, but sex selective abortion, coming from sex determination, is illegal. So that's, to maintain that distinction, you need the doctors, to be under watch. You need the this law to be implemented properly. But you don't find any of that happening. The sex ratio is so bad in Haryana, but still one of the studies showed that in 6 months before the Haryana chief minister made this declaration of a change, a radical change, only 58 cases had been registered under this law that bans sex determination against, erring doctors. So this is a very low number, and it's not a conviction. It's just cases registered. So there is no evidence that the government is actually going any harder against the doctors, right? None at all. And the other question is, of course, if you talk about what the central government is doing about this law. It's very interesting because there's a powerful medical lobby in India that is saying that that wants this law gone. They're saying,
people are doing it. People are the ones who are backward and they are the ones who are anti-women and so on. It's not our fault. So you should stop making it illegal for doctors to do sex determination. So they've been saying, you know, you get rid of this law. And quite some months ago, you had the minister for, you know, women's development in India, in the central government, Menaka Gandhi. She made a public statement exactly to this effect, saying we should get rid of this law. We should make sex determination compulsory and then surveil, you know, unleash surveillance on, watch the women who are pregnant with female fetuses. So she basically was saying, don't watch the doctors, just watch the women, you know, watch the pregnant women, just make sure they are not. So she had to retract that statement because there was quite an outcry about it. So she said, oh, I was just thinking out loud and all of that. But she wasn't, because there is a doctor's lobby that's been arguing for this for a very long time. So it was very, very well planned what she said. And the larger question is whether sex selection can be addressed at all without, you know, just on its own like that, you know, that we just want a better outcome. We want some better indicators. So if we just, you know, have these older women in the village do surveillance on pregnant mothers, you know, and just somehow prevent, you know, make sure daughters are born. Can you really challenge it without challenging the larger, you know, metrics of regressive patriarchy, lock, stock and barrel, you know? So the Haryana chief minister now, for instance, Manohar Lal Khattar, all chief ministers in Haryana, even the previous one from the Congress government, this person is from the BJP, even they, none of them said a word. They all made appreciative noises about the Khap panchayats. They would never open their mouths and say that the Khap panchayats are responsible for these, you know, so-called honor killings and other kind, you know, impositions of dress codes on women and all of that. They all did that. But Khattar went even a step further. Manohar Lal Khattar is, you know, who's the chief minister now. When, before he became chief minister, he said about a year before he became chief minister that, I'll try and get that thing out. Yeah. So this is what he said. He said that the Khaps are great because they maintain this tradition of brother and sister. And they're just making sure that a girl and a boy look at each other as brother and sister, and they're not going to look at each other the wrong way. And he said, you know, if girls dress decently, if they wear skirts, they're luring boys into sexual violence and all of that. And he asked women who, you know, he was asked by this journalist, but what about the fact that girls are saying they want freedom? So he said, what's this freedom? Do they want the freedom to roam around naked? Freedom has to be limited. And, you know, short clothes are a Western influence and all of that, that a lot of people, you know, it's a quite familiar kind of victim blaming and sexism in India to say that all this is Western, all these concerns are Western and clothes are Western and so on. But the point is, he's now chief minister, and you see him hosting these Beti Bachao events. So he's rebranding himself as a progressive chief minister who's doing things for girls and girls' education. And he is gracing, you know, he has the U.S. ambassador gracing these functions. His functions are funded by, for instance, this event is a Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao event. You know, the camera hasn't focused on the U.S. ambassador, sadly, it's focused on someone else. But, you know, you can see it says Richard Verma there. That is the U.S. ambassador to India. So he is attending these events, he's giving speeches there, and Khattar is basically... what's the purpose of those events, except as an advertisement for the government, which is saying that here we are actually, you know, doing all these nice feminist sounding things that can get some international attention and funding and all of that. And this is a government. I also want to just underline that, because this is a government which, you know, when sometime back last year, when there was this Jat agitation for quotas and year and a half ago. And the agitators pulled women down from buses and gang raped them at a place called Murthal in Haryana. And there was a lot of evidence for that, but the police and the government systematically denied. They branded all the women complainants as liars. They said none of this has happened.
And the chief minister himself, he presided over this. So the man who says that skirts cause rape, he is the same person, and he's also talking about, oh, I'm all for women's education and women's empowerment. He is somebody who's actually preventing justice in rape cases. Quite recently, there was a Chandigarh, High Court rap on the knuckles for him, saying that we've viewed the evidence and we are of the view that rape has occurred. So they've ordered the Haryana government to make sure that cases are filed and something moves. And it's being monitored by the court now. But, I'm just mentioning that to say that this is the reality when you have this government also claiming, Beti Bachao and all of that at the same time. So, Now, what about the Beti Padhao part of it, the education part of it? I want to mention there that a larger and larger number of Indian families are wanting to educate girls. So education itself, the wish to send a daughter to school and all of that is there, all right? But there are several reasons why, education stops at a certain point or it's difficult to continue. Because even in rural India, you have families wanting to send their daughters to school and all of that. The thing is that for one thing, that schooling and education is not necessarily only seen as a way of, later earning and all of that. It's also to some extent seen as, a degree of education and then marriage is the route seen. But that apart, the thing is that, the situation of schools in India, the availability of schools, the fact that government schooling tends to be of a poor quality, good schooling is more expensive, all of these things are, things that affect girls' schooling in India. They're not changing or touching any of that. They're not really making it easier for girls to go to school. So that it's basically this nice looking campaign that says educate daughters and, that kind of thing. But I want to raise something a little more, a little more in keeping with what I initially raised, which was this concern about women's autonomy. Because you have students in India, women students in India who are in colleges and universities, for instance, very loudly raising this issue that we generally, in order to study outside, we have to go to college, university, sometimes we have to stay in hostels and all of that. And our colleges and universities, and if we are staying in hostels, then hostels, they discriminate against us as women and they do it in the name of safety. They do it in the name of keeping us safe from sexual violence. Whereas actually, if we want to go out and file, if we want to complain of sexual harassment at our college or university or anything like that, then we are discouraged from doing that. That is considered bad behavior and that is discouraged. Any movement against sexual harassment is shut down. There's a crackdown on it. You're publicly shamed for doing that. But you're told that you will be locked up for your own safety and all of that. So in fact, there was a UGC committee, UGC team that had University Grants Commission, that is. University Grants Commission in 2013 had set up this committee that had come up with a report because several people on that committee were experienced activists, both in education as well as in the women's movement. And they had prepared this report, and in the course of the report, basically it was recommendations for safety on campuses. So they had spoken to a lot of women students on campuses, and those women students had said that locking up women is not the answer. They said that wherever they went, this was something that young women students everywhere would tell them. This was a major concern. They said that the custodial responsibility of the university is to make the spaces safe enough for us to live in with a sense of freedom and equality. And there were protests everywhere about early hostel hours when women students had to be, in by 6 p.m. or hostel terraces are locked up by 6:30 or not open at all, or transport between the main campus and undergraduate hostel stops at 7 p.m. and or in some universities there's no transport at all, and or libraries are not allowed for women after a certain period and all of that. So they kept stressing this, that this is not the way forward, and this is what the Saksham report also, it was called the Saksham report, so it had these recommendations. Unpredictably, the recommendations are there, but no one wants to look at them, no one wants to follow them. So colleges and universities and hostels in India continued to go their own sweet way. And, you know, the 2013 thing came in the wake of the 2012, you know, gang rape incident and the concern about violence against women then. I mean, that movement also, if you recall, one of the strongest, points made by a lot of women participants in that movement was, don't make us trade off our freedom in the name of our safety. Because this, us locking us up is a form of violence against us, and we don't want that. This was something very strongly made. Now, the good part is that the movements have continued. So you have, this. For instance, just I want to give you one example. You have this Pinjara Tod movement. Pinjara is cage, so it says break the hostel locks or break the cages. Pinjara Tod, and this is a movement, feminist movement of young women students in Delhi University, which has attracted a large number of participants. And basically, they started by saying exactly this: that the hostel discriminatory rules in hostels have to go. But they have also, of course, raised a whole lot of other, feminist issues as well. And it's a very it's a growing new group, a new feminist movement in India. Now, look at the I want to show you this Pinjara Tod poster. If you can read what that says, it says, no warden is protector, no brother who is tough, my feminist comrades are enough. And they had that in several languages. And they have been, of course, attacked by the right-wing groups there, the students group associated with the ruling party. They've said these are girls of poor character. They've done silly things like throwing coins at these girls, these young women, when they're marching on the street, basically to say that, you know, they're available for money. So, you know, it's like you're performing for money, and so we can throw coins at you and stuff like that. So the ABVP people ABVP is the students' wing of the ruling party. And they've done that. And they've done that even with students activists of the All India Students Association as well, in several places in Lucknow as well as in Delhi. So this is the kind of violence that they face. Now, my point is that, the state's policies continue to insist on these rules and regulations. And they do it in the name of doing a lot of good for women. That's what they'll say, that we are creating safe structures so women can come and study. But they'll be hedged around with all these discriminatory rules. So discrimination is packaged as safety, and it's still very common policy. And now the additional, it's also laced with this whole, Hindu right-wing ideology now. There's that extra lacing. I'm not saying that it started there. This is a policy that has a long, history in India. But it's laced with that now, because now it's also to say, there's this overt danger out there, that not just danger of violence, but the danger of your daughter's own freedom. You know, there was a BJP leader supporter in Gujarat who said some years ago that your daughter's, everybody has a bomb in their house. Your daughter is a bomb. She may explode. And then your caste, your family boundaries and your caste boundaries, So you have to really police those borders of your home and your caste. He said that in so many words. So this is the extra kind of lacing that's happening with these kinds of rules and regulations that women are fighting. And then you have these BJP leaders who've said, women activists in campuses have been called loose women, shameless women, women who dance naked at night and stuff like that by these, leaders of these parties. Are we running short of time? Yeah, okay. So I just go on to the next one quickly, and then we'll end with that. It's just the last bit. So yeah, I'll just take 5 or 7 minutes. Yeah. So I wanted to look at the Swachh Bharat campaign. I'll quickly go to the Swachh Bharat campaign. So this is a poster of the Right to Pee campaign in Mumbai, which is a feminist campaign. A lot of groups have done it, basically saying that we need more public toilets, especially for women, in Indian cities. So basically, they're talking about women's right to access these public spaces more easily, and that women's toilets in public spaces is a recognition that women are going to be out there at all hours of day and night, and you need toilets for them. And my own organization, I took up this kind of a campaign in Delhi as well, where we did surveys of how few toilets there are available. Not only toilets available in public spaces for women, but also toilets available, for instance, domestic workers. So women domestic workers or sanitation workers who sweep the streets and so on, they will leave their house very early in the morning, going to the toilet somewhere out on the street or in some public place. And the whole day they will not have any access to any toilet at all day. So one of the demands, for toilets and so on has actually been coming from the feminist movement. I wanted to put that out there because now you have this government campaign saying clean India and saying build more toilets in your homes and, doing all this, very visible campaign saying build toilets. And, the Prime Minister said, will there be any other Prime Minister who'll talk about toilets? But I've talked about toilets and all of that because he's trying to say, that I'm willing to actually, talk about this thing. It's not a dirty thing. It's this good. So he's actually seemed very progressive and modern saying all this, right? But I want to look at whether it has addressed this issue at all. And the other aspect is the question that sanitation work in India is done hugely by Dalit workers of the most oppressed caste who are considered untouchable and so on. And they have for very long been demanding an overhaul of India's sanitation systems to ensure an end to manual scavenging and more rights and dignity for sanitation workers. And I just want to quickly show you some photographs of struggles of women sanitation workers. So this is an activist of the Bangalore Contract Safai Karmacharis Union. It's a union which is associated with the All India Central Council of Trade Unions. And, look, their struggles, I'll just show you a couple more photos. So if you go to those struggles, these are highly vocal, very well-attended struggles of a very large number of women, all of whom are Dalit, who clean the streets of Bangalore. And it's they have been demanding, they've recently had a very, their success in one of their struggles, which is they managed to get their minimum wages increased from 7,000 a month to, almost double that amount. Plus, so it's 14,000 a month now, plus there's a 3,000 rupee risk allowance that they managed to win. And they also were demanding toilets and drinking water for themselves. I mean, it's ironic, they're cleaning out there, but they don't have any sanitation for themselves. So they were demanding food during the day and all of that. They were demanding basic cleaning tools as well as safety tools, safety things like gum boots and masks. A recent health survey, I was in Bangalore recently, at that time they'd done this health survey, and they found that most of the women are suffering from mouth cancer. Why? Because they chew tobacco, and that's because they have to avoid drinking water because water is not available and also loos are not available. So in order to keep the saliva coming in the mouth, keep the mouth from getting too dry, and they're working in dusty places all the time. So they're chewing tobacco, and that means that most of them have mouth cancer. And they also have a lot of eye problems from dust, from the dust flying into their eyes, so eye injuries and so on, very, very common. So they've been demanding that these facilities in order to prevent that. But the Swachh Bharat campaign is completely, to shut its ears to these concerns. It's as though they're not there. But are they not concerned about women? The Swachh Bharat Clean India campaign, its most visible or audible emotional appeals are, to women's safety and women's dignity. Women's honor, if that's the way they put it. So I'll show you a couple of advertisements. This is just the last, and this we're just ending the end. So I'll, so this is a campaign, this is a slogan that says, Bahu betiyan dur na jaye, ghar mein hi shauchalay banwaye. So it means, daughters and daughters-in-law, don't go far away from the house, construct a toilet in your own house. Remember, we looked at that right in the beginning, that restriction, keep inside the house, is something which is a form of violence that women face. And this is actually speaking directly to that. It's telling people, construct, and all the campaigns are worded like this. The Swachh Bharat campaign, you could find any number of examples. I'll just share three with you. This is one. Here's another that says, Ma ghar mein ghoongat tera saathi, fir kyun shauch khule mein jaati. That means, mother, your veil is your companion in your home, so why do you defecate in the open? And so this is all about honor, right? Keeping the ghungat is the veil. So the veil is about protecting your honor. So if you're that honorable that you use the veil, you know, why are you exposing your backside, going outside to the loo? Basically, that's what it is. And I remember there was an advertisement with one of the best known actresses in India, Vidya Balan, who did an advertisement with the Swachh Bharat campaign, where she goes into a home where the mother-in-law has just, she introduces her to the daughter-in-law. The daughter-in-law has a ghungat all the way till here, because she's covered her face. And then Vidya Balan asks the mother-in-law, do you have a toilet in the house? And she says, no. She says, oh, tab to ghungat khol hi do. You know, you might as well remove the veil, because if you're going to send your daughter outside to the bathroom, you might as well remove the veil. So this is actually something saying that veiling your daughter-in-law is a form of honor, and you are dishonoring, you know, yourself and your home and your daughter-in-law by making her go outside. So feminist groups have flagged all of this and have said that this is the exact opposite of what Neet saying. We've been asking for public toilets in order to increase mobility of women. Now you are asking for, you know, toilets in the home is a necessity, but for hygiene reasons. Ending defecation in the open is necessity for health reasons. But you are using this kind of messaging, which is reinforcing, you know, all the patriarchal messaging. And the other point, which I'll make the last point, is that the Clean India campaign, you know, Bayswater Wilson, who is a campaigner for the liberation of manual scavengers in India, has made this point really well. So I'll just share his quote right at the end, where he says that he points out quite correctly that Swachh means pure. And the scheme is for the toilet users, not for the toilet cleaners. So it's talking about purity. It's talking of the, you know, which is associated with the dominant caste, and pollution is associated with the Dalits, who are the cleaners. So he's making this point, and I just want to make that last point here, that this campaign is very much reinforcing both the Beti Bachao campaign and the Swachh Bharat campaign are very much framed by the, you know, dominant caste and gender framework. They're also very much located in the idea of restricting women's mobility and of denying women's autonomy. They also have a larger resonance with the the attacks of on the rights of women and Dalits in the country, and yet these are campaigns that are seen from afar and even inside India as being campaigns that are feathers, you know, the flagship campaigns that are good things. Criticize the government, but why do you criticize these campaigns? They're good campaigns. You know, they're at least doing a good thing. They're asking for, you know, good things to happen and all of that. So I hope, we can, address questions after this, but I'll end my talk.
Thank you very much, Kavita. I'm going to hand over to Alpa, who will act as discussant, and then open the floor afterwards.
Thank you so much, Kavita. I thought that was a really, really illuminating talk. When I first went out to India, it was in 1999, and I was really interested in looking at one of these kinds of campaigns, the development of women and children in rural areas, which was a big UNICEF-funded campaign. And, there I was, set out to do this PhD, looking at the impact of this program, and I turn up in rural Jharkhand, and I find that actually this program doesn't exist at all. You know, it's only in the books of the block development officers. It doesn't exist on the ground at all. And of course, the entire PhD had turned into something very different. But I think since those times, what you are describing we've seen kind of some certain fundamental shifts in India, and what we have, what you've presented to us, is this kind of very heady mix of the spread of neoliberal capitalism combined with the kind of Hindu right-wing forces that are promoting some of the processes related to it, to the spread of capitalism. And this kind of combination is giving us a very particular particular spread of the control of women's bodies. And I was thinking a lot about the work of Silvia Federici, and thinking about how what the similarities and differences are with what we're seeing in contemporary India, you know, with the you know, her argument being that the primitive accumulation of capitalism has been based on removing women from the historical struggle for the commons and taking away women's autonomy and placing them inside the household as housewives so that their labor in reproduction basically made, you know, their labor in reproducing male workers becomes like unpaid labor. So if, you know, increasing housewifeization of women, controlling women's bodies and sexualities. And of course, she was talking about a very different period in European history, but I think we're seeing this kind of spread of capitalism and an increasing control of women's bodies in India. And I wanted to ask you really a few questions about this. I mean, to what extent do you think what we're seeing right now is quite different to the past, is quite different to what we might have seen, you know, 20 years ago, what we might have seen in a different, with a different kind of government in front. So, I mean, that's one set of, you know, one kind of question that I had. But I also wanted to ask you more specifically about, you know, something that you referred to when you were talking about, you know, looking at sex selection and how we can't really address just this. We've got to challenge the much larger matrices of patriarchy, and of course, you know, I mean, this is a question about the women's movement in general in India, but. To me, I've had a lot of inspiration from working with Adivasi and Dalit women across India, and it seems that, you know, the challenges to such forces that we're seeing in India, that as you've described in your presentation, have to come from both an ideological and a material front. So you've got to have a kind of double-edged challenge, but also we do, you know, I was wondering, to your examples were mainly from Haryana. But I wondered to what extent such campaigns are actually having as great a spread or as great an appeal in many other parts of India. For example, those dominated in particular by Adivasis and Dalits. Because what we also have in India is a very different model of male-female relations, especially amongst Adivasi and Dalit communities, a much greater autonomy within households in both of these communities, quite different ideas of femininity, feminist men even, I would say, especially amongst Adivasi communities. And I've often thought, you know, about how we have these kind of much more positive models of gender relations, which of course with upward mobility and increasing education change amongst these communities, but the ways in which we may have a kind of strike back that comes from Adivasi and Dalit communities. And I was, you know, it's quite interesting to see that the Karamchari, the Safai Karamcharis, you know, the union protest demanding better wages, it's coming from Dalit women, and you know, we've had other campaigns, like for example the Kerala women workers strikes and the tea plantations, again coming from Dalit women, and which have been actually greatly supported by Dalit men in those areas. So we have these quite different models of what it means to be a woman, of challenges to patriarchy from within those communities, which are actually silenced in these overall models. And I was wondering if you could tell us something about, you know, the more positive struggles that we're seeing, the kind of fights that we can see emerging from Adivasi or Dalit communities in India. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah. So What's different about this particular juncture? I mean, I'd like to say to begin with that I think most of the state-led campaigns, I mean, even if you look at another state, for instance, which I've looked at closely, which is Bihar, which is not ruled by the Bharatiya Janata Party. It is ruled by Nitish Kumar, and his Janata Dal United also speaks the language of women's empowerment and all of that in quite a big way. So he said we're giving cycles to little girls and to enable them to go to school and all of that. But what we found even there also is that the attitude of the state is basically very paternalistic, and it's also, you know, quite hostile to, you know, women's autonomy. So women who are women, rural women workers and so on, their struggles have been dealt with quite brutally by the state. You know, they're not really easy or comfortable with women organizing to make demands of the state. They're only comfortable with, you know, saying things that they are willing to do for those women, but not really to respond to demands by the women and, you know, speak to them as such. So that is something that has lost that government. In fact, Nitish Kumar, a considerable degree of support that he had initially from, you know, women health workers, for instance, in rural Bihar. So I didn't want to say, I mean, that, you know, what is specific about these campaigns, I think, is what I felt. It's also, there's this extra layer of the Hindu right wing, you know, resonance as well that is added to these specific campaigns. So that's one thing that is, you know, that sets it apart from earlier times. But I also think there's other things. I think that, you know, the labor participation rates and so on are still quite low in India for women. But basically, you do have, however, newer sections of women who are coming out to work for the first time. So it isn't only that they're wanting, you know, housewifeization alone. It's that these anxieties are really sharp right now, and people are out to, you know, anxieties about if my daughter goes out to study, you know, women are going out to study and to work and so on. So if my daughter goes out to study and goes out to work and so on, the anxiety is there about what her conduct will be, what her sexual conduct will be, what her, you know, how her, you know, how her behavior will be, what changes will happen there. So I think what these campaigns do and what state policies do and what even the Hindu right-wing policies and other, you know, caste groups, politics and all of that, they're all looking at different ways of harnessing that anxiety in their own favor. So they are looking for ways to say, you can do well by your daughter, but you can also control, you know, continue to control her. You can also, you know, you can be a good, you know, you can look good. You can post these selfies with your daughter, basically, and, you know, say that I have a daughter and I'm doing well by her and all of that, while at the same time continuing to, you know, feel very comfortable and very, you know, the state is with you and we're all with you in all the restrictions that, in fact, that we will help you to impose. So it's not only what they're saying to families. What I'm trying to say is they're actually trying to create this constituency and play to it. And the BJP is doing it, of course, big time. And these state campaigns are, you know, are tailored to that in some way. And their overall policies towards education and so on are also tailored there. Even their attempts to change, you know, higher education and how they're looking at campuses and all is very much framed by that, you know, one of these aspects. And their uneasiness with Dalit assertion, with feminist assertion, all of that is extremely clear. And at the same time, you also have, you know, one of the things which I didn't have much time to talk about, I'll briefly mention it here, is that, you know, the thing is, even in the media in India and all of that, you know, now you will have a lot of attention. If there's a Khap Panchayat or a political leader who announces that a ban on mobile phones for girls, you'll have it on primetime TV immediately. But if a factory in Tamil Nadu, a garment factory in Tamil Nadu that's producing for global brands, if it does the identical same thing with hostels in which women Dalit workers, young women Dalit workers are staying, then it will not be that kind of news. It's done there quite routinely, and women workers are, you know, virtually kept in bonded labor there and not allowed to use mobile phones. And the, you know, just to tie up with the question you raised about Adivasi and Dalit women, well, yes and no. You know, I would say that in our experience of working in those communities as well, I would say that while there are different models, the same kinds of patriarchy are not in place, but I would say that the anxiety over controlling marriage outside the community or sexual relationships outside the community is by now probably quite ubiquitous. It is very strong in a lot of places. We have felt that even in the work among Dalit agricultural workers in Bihar, there's a lot of assertion, a lot of struggles over a lot of things. But if you ask them, because of the history of struggles there, which we've been part of, there's also a lot of solidarity with Muslims and so on who are living close by. But the one thing on which you still find that there is still a lot of gap is that when you ask about, what if your daughter falls in love with a Muslim man, then they'll say, but that will make her a bad girl. That is not a good thing. It's there. It's very, very strong. It's very deep rooted. And the BJP and all know this. They are playing to that because they know that that is the vulnerable place. And Dalit men who marry a non-Dalit woman and the violence the whole community faces as a result, they're all familiar with that. They've been part of resistance to that. But a Dalit woman who might fall in love outside the community, even within Dalits, just marry outside the community, fall in love, is something which can invite a considerable degree of, maybe not the same kind of organized violence kind of thing, but a lot of hostility. So I think that that's also there. I'm not trying to flatten out the differences there, but just to say that I think that even in those movements, one would have to be, instead of, I think even those struggles can't afford to be, among Adivasi and Dalit movements, for instance, can't afford to be complacent about the fact that over there also, autonomy is not. And just to end that point, the factories I mentioned. Now, these are young women in Tamil Nadu who used to be from families that did agricultural work. But now they're being recruited to come and live for 2 or 3 years in these garment workers' hostels, and the hostels the factories are advertising these kinds of restrictions to those communities in order to say these are being done so that your daughters will be quite safe, and she won't be she won't be spoiled over there. She will be, the point we make when we address that is that, look, usually when women start going out and working, even in the fields or even out and or outside somewhere, then there is a degree of freedom and mobility, right? Which, however uneasy a family may be with it, they will eventually get used to it. It will find its own level at some point. But when a factory, when an entire system backed by the government sort of freezes it in place, it's much more hardened than the kind of patriarchy they would find at home. It's much more, the surveillances are of an entirely different order entirely. And that is why it poses such a hostility. These are some of the changes I would say we are seeing. Yeah.
Okay, so we'll start taking questions. I'm going to take them in rounds of three or maybe four. Lady back there. Yep.
Of the selfie campaign that happened with the actress Shruti Singh, supporting role in Bollywood. She's one of the people who's on a high level, spoke to an audience, rather than taking selfies, perform actually helped. This opposition been like high level besides Shruti Singh? What has been the backlash to the right voices?
Okay, lady at the back, yeah.
Difference when the leader of the state one more? Yeah. Maybe, yeah. First of all, thank you. I thought you got every point, and it was a fabulous service. But I feel, like sometimes these campaigns are very selective, and they have their own interpretation of women empowerment and feminism. So they focus on only those campaigns which they think that, like how they thought that selfie is actually a good thing, and they're going to promote it. I don't know, what I see the main problem is this mostly is the implementation problem. And there are campaigns, not even if they are state-led or even if they are state-funded, the whole problem which comes around to me is implementation. And I just want to know, like, how you working in an organization, I'm sure it must be sometimes frustrating that it's there, you know it, and there are laws, the international legal framework is there, which, like, for example, India's Party to Zero, where you're supposed to have implement those things, but you're still not doing. So how do you overcome these things? How do you make sure that they are there? I'm not saying that there is no progress, but for me, I don't see it as a progress. Like, I feel like there is so much lot more has to be done, and it's not still there.
I'll start with what you asked about. You know, I think in my view, demands must be made of the state, because the state does control the allocation of resources. Change is not going to happen. I mean, you know, even if you're fighting for a larger change in, you know, in the very structure of the state and the structure of society, you are also going to have to make demands of an existing state as well, which controls resources and the allocation of them, and which holds power. So I think that the argument that feminists basically rely on the state, I mean, I think that those groups that sort of work with the state, that say that we are partnering with the state, I think that, you know, some of the groups that do that and take funding from the state and so on, I would distinguish from those, and I would say that yes, I see that there is a problem there. But I think that largely in the women's movement, especially in the kind of organizations to which I belong, and similar groups which have been of a left orientation, which are some of the largest groups in India, I think that they have, very systematically not taken any funding from the state and not taken any kind of funding from any other agencies either. So the point is that even we would make demands of the state. We would demand, for instance, we've been demanding maternity entitlements for women, right? Which the state has now, the Modi just announced it now. It was accepted into law 2 years back, but now he didn't implement it. It was announced by the previous government, but he didn't implement it. And now, when he was facing some concerns about what people's growing disillusionment with demonetization, then he announced it in his end of December speech as though that was some kind of largesse he had suddenly thought of the top of his head. So of course people are going to harness it and hitch it to their respective political wagons and so on. But that doesn't mean that we are not going to make demands of the state or expect these entitlements as entitlements. So I think the struggle there is also about what we how we run our campaigns and what we make then of something like maternity entitlements, which are extremely necessary and important thing. So now that it's been announced, we would be fighting to make sure it is implemented, which ties up with what you're saying, to make sure, and how would we do that? We would be doing that by organizing women to demand where they have not got the entitlements, what are the structures by which those entitlements are being denied. Those are the things we would be exposing and demanding, right? And the other thing is, you asked about criminalization. I'm not sure what, I don't share that critique of it at all, because I feel that, to say that, violence against women ought not to be a crime seems to me, because the state is eventually going to be the one that is going to enact those laws and that has the criminal system in its hands. I think that itself is not the answer. And the feminist movement has not exactly been demanding, criminalization. It has, those laws, the criminal laws exist. The point is that the feminist movement is bound to be, working with survivors of violence, who are naturally going to, approach the state machinery and so on for access to recognition of the fact that they have faced violence, and then the
justice process that will follow. Justice does not begin and end only with the criminal system, but the criminal system is, criminal justice system is a part of it. It's bound to be a part of it. So I think the feminist movement has not worked as an arm of the criminal justice system. It has worked often in contention with that system and how that system has betrayed survivors of violence largely. So I think the changes in law, for instance, the rape law changes and all that feminist movement demanded, we're not to say that that does not make the rape law that is passed at the end of it, it's not that the feminist movement has ownership or responsibility for that law entirely. There were many things we demanded that eventually did get enacted into law, and there were plenty of things that got enacted into law which were the exact opposite of what we demanded, and many things that are not yet recognized. And I think that it's not about something about only demanding. If you look at the demand, for instance, for recognizing the need for a law against custodial family violence on crimes, the point is that there is no recognition for it now. It's not what governments will tell you is that if there's a killing, you have a law for murder. The point is that the violence is unleashed much before the killing, and the attacks on women's autonomy is happening a lot before that. So when you approach the state for support there, you're told that this is a private sphere and we can't do anything about it. This is a family, work it out amongst yourselves kinds of things. So I think that the demand is for a recognition that this is a problem, and to that effect, and to hold the state accountable to actually doing its duty of upholding constitutional rights and values, and that's about it. So the other question, which was about you asked about Shruti Seth and so on. Self-Even Daughter campaign, when it was announced, Shruti also had made statements, and so had I, and so had several others, and we'd been attacked very violently abused by Modi's supporters and all of that. But I don't think we in the women's movement didn't actually sort of launch a campaign against it. What we did there was to, during that period, was to say, and during this entire Beti Bachao thing, is to talk, is to organize women in many places to say that, to contrast what the government is claiming with what is actually happening. So, for instance, in many places we've said, we've held campaigns to say, you're saying Beti Padhao, you're saying educate your daughter, and look at how you're treating women who are seeking education. You're telling them you're shameless women if you're complaining against sexual harassment. So if you didn't want to be molested, then stay at home and all of that. So, we have been, that's the way in which we have been taking it on and challenging it. There's, of course, been a lot of right-wing backlash, including when I criticized the Selfie with Daughter campaign, there was a supporter of Mr. Modi on Twitter, who one of the handles he follows, who said to me, if women are going to, if a daughter is going to grow up into someone like you, no wonder she's killed. She should be killed at birth, or before she's born, and so on. So the idea is, which basically confirmed exactly what we were saying, which is that we want daughters to be born in order to fulfill various functions and obey the patriarchal order, but we don't want feminist daughters to be born. We don't want women to be feminist or autonomous. You asked about whether somebody like Jayalalitha and whether schemes are introduced by her, by a woman leader, and so on, would make a difference. I would say yes and no. One is, I would like to remind that, for instance, this Tamil Nadu scheme, right, this which I mentioned, under which the garment workers were employed, was called the Sumangali scheme, and it has been there both in DMK as well as AIFDMK times. Sumangali means this whole idea that workers will stay, young women workers between the ages of 18 and 20, 21, will stay in a hostel and get a lump sum payment at the end of the 3 years. Why? Because it's like they're going to be earning their dowry. And the name of the scheme was called Sumangali scheme. So Sumangali means in Tamil a good, sort of auspicious word for a married woman. So somebody whose husband is alive is a Sumangali. So That scheme was there even, and they had to withdraw the official scheme because of these exposes over how the women were being treated there and the fact that there was a lot of bonded labor and child labor there. But the bonded labor and child labor continued. They withdrew the official scheme where the government was backing these recruitments. But the recruitments continued, and they just changed the name of the scheme and they just changed the order. So that's one thing. The other thing is that the Tamil Nadu has had different indicators there. Tamil Nadu has a lot of female infanticide, very high infanticide. So the Jayalalitha government did introduce things like the cradle baby scheme, where they said, you know, someone getting rid of a baby girl can instead leave the child in a government run shelter, basically. So some of those things, they have had a mixed effect and all of that. And there are there are some schemes. As I said, some of those schemes were schemes that were being demanded by the women's movement. For instance, demands for pensions for older people, especially older women, which have undoubtedly allowed older women to be more independent of less dependent on their sons and fathers and so on. But that is there in other states as well. And Jayalalitha also projected herself as being, it was a sort of paternalistic amma, right? She said, "I'm mother, and so you must trust me, and I will take care of all of you because I'm your mother," and all of that. So it wasn't. Jayalalitha's government was also most uncomfortable with Dalit movements as well as women's movements. It has been its police has been quite brutal with Dalits struggling against it. Tamil Nadu has seen some of the worst violence against Dalits. And what was the nature of that violence? I just want to flag that there. That there are groups in Tamil Nadu, of the middle caste, the Vanyar caste and so on, who have been trying to carve out a political identity separate from the AIDMK and DMK, which have been basically campaigning against intercaste marriage, especially against marriage of our girls with Dalit men. And they have unleashed violence against such marriages, unleashed violence against the entire Dalit community, where a Dalit man has married into a woman of their community and all of that. And all that violence, Jayalalitha never uttered a single word over there with that. So I think that essentially I would say that the patriarchal framework was very much in place, even though there's been a lot of eulogies about some of her welfare schemes. But the point is that those welfare schemes, as I said, it's like the maternity entitlement scheme. People have been fighting for many of those things as an entitlement from the state. Whereas Jayalalitha did, implement those schemes, but did it saying, "I'm doing it as a benevolent, my Bap Sarkar, a government that is going to be a parent to its people, right?" Yeah, and the last thing you asked about implementation. I don't think it's not just about things being in place and implementation. I think it's a little more important to look at what is the, why a state has, a progressive sounding constitution, and it guarantees, the constitution guarantees certain rights, then you have CEDAW and all of that and lots of things. But then why is it that a state then does not do it? It's not just because the system isn't working and we just have to get the system working. It's also because the system, as I said, and as Alpa also pointed out, it also has an interest in denying women's autonomy. A state would not be very comfortable or happy with a situation where women are more assertive about their autonomy. They're able to come out, they're able to organize, unionize, come out and struggle, right? The reason why these factories and so on, the government is saying, "Make in India." So in a way, it's as though it's not because the system isn't working that this stuff is happening, but rather because the system is working. And the system is actually looking towards us, making sure that if you're having Make in India and you want a docile workforce, for instance, then you will want to make sure that your factories are places where women find it harder to organize. You don't want workers in general to organize, but the ways in which you will discipline women workers are different because of the availability of different patriarchal tools you can use to organize there, right? So you're invoking patriarchy there to say that, it's culture, it's Tamil Nadu culture, it's Indian culture that parents want their girls to be, you know, locked up safely in hostels when they're not actually at the workplace. They don't want them to be having mobile phones and speaking to boyfriends and making friends with men. But actually, you know, the woman with a mobile phone in her hand will, of course, be having friendships and relationships, but she will also be organizing and unionizing and so on, which is effectively prevented then by the factory, right? Yeah.
Okay. We have time, hopefully, for one more round of questions, if not two. So,
okay.
The lady here.
Stops such extreme versions of course, also his expression of underlying patriarchal ideology, but there's also so many other things than that.
Yeah.
The lady back there, yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, okay. So I think, in fact, your question and yours can, I'll take them together because they're related. I think that undoubtedly, I mean, where, especially in areas where the Adivasis are, in larger numbers in India, those tend to be the forest areas and so on. And this particular, this Indian state has always unleashed an absolutely, for the past several years, a very concerted kind of violence there, which is primarily because those are resource-rich areas. There are forest and mineral resources there, water resources there, and so on, land there. And basically, there are laws that specially protect the rights of Adivasis to land and resources. And they have been attacking, finding ways to grab that land. Very large corporations have an eye on those resources and land, and so there have been very powerful movements in those areas, undoubtedly, where Adivasi women have been at the forefront of those struggles, and there's also been very severe repression there. So I think that, you know, that is very much a larger context where, and this particular government, in fact, has really unleashed a,
for instance, in Jharkhand, I'm sure you've been following that, Alpa, about the attempts to dismantle even the traditional laws, the PCP, the CNT and SPT acts, which protect the rights of Adivasis to land and all of that. And there's been a lot of systematic, the state violence, especially in the conflict areas in the country, anywhere in the country, but certainly where Adivasi women are there, there is state violence unleashed by the police and the state machinery is also extremely common. And it's become much worse in the Chhattisgarh region now in the last few years. It's sharpened. I mean, so it's been very bad there for a long while. But in recent times, there was an intensification of that with the state virtually announcing that there is a time period that they're following a calendar, and that by a certain date, very soon, they want to actually free those areas. They say free those areas of the Maoists, but basically it's freeing those areas of the people who live there, the Adivasis, and there are corporations waiting in line to basically having their eye on those areas. So some of the violence there has, of course, meant absolutely systematic. I mean, sexual violence by the police and state forces. But, they would arrest women and rape them in custody, as well as, do these combing operations, search and, raid and search operations, supposedly looking for Maoists in the villages, but raping women in the name of doing that. So that kind of, activists working in those areas, whether they are Adivasis from Chhattisgarh or whether they are people or trying to offer legal aid or just trying to, stay there and bear witness to what's happening and, stay there and, speak about it, write about it, report from those areas. They were all attacked and subjected to violence by vigilante groups patronized by the police and so on. There's been a small sort of very small significant development there where the police officer in charge of some of the worst of these atrocities, the state eventually found it to be a little too embarrassing because one of the activists who had been helping Adivasi women to report the sexual crimes against them by the police to the National Human Rights Commission, following, they had already spoken about these things to a large platform of women's groups called the Women Against Sexual Violence and State Repression, WSS. And after 1.5 to 2 years of trying, then the Human Rights Commission had finally gone there. And on the ground, this Bela Bhatia, who's a well-known researcher and activist, had helped to help these women to actually, report, speak to the NHRC. And subsequently, there was an attack by a vigilante group on Bela Bhatia's house, and they threatened to burn her house down and unleash a lot of violence if she did not leave. So she did leave that house, but she said, "I'm not leaving Bastar." And in the outcry that followed, I mean, women's rights activists sent texts to the police officer to say what's happening and you can't do this. And he literally sent texts back saying, "Fuck you," literally, I mean, those are the words used. So, and saying, "I'm going to clear Bastar of Naxalites and dogs," those are the words he used. So he, I think that those use of those words and the fact that those were publicized made him a little too, hot to hold for the government. So they've sent him on medical leave. They haven't taken any action against the fact that he's accused of rape and that he's accused of encouraging rape as a policy there and fake encounters and custodial killings there, none of that. But he has had to proceed on leave. They've claimed it's medical leave, but he is taking a lot of pains to keep talking about it and say he's perfectly fit and fine, he's not ill, and it's a victory for the human rights defenders. So, he's making that rather clear. But it's still a very hard struggle there, undoubtedly, and very, very difficult one. So, I'll talk about the PCPNDT Act in Rajasthan a little later, because connected with this is what Kalpana asked about, which is the in the Beti Padhao scheme of things. I mean, all over India you have, for instance, and this also links up with the whole issue of the rights of Adivasi and Dalit girls and their right to education, because we are in fact
considering the need for having some kind of you know, countrywide study, at least in several states, about the homes run by various state governments and you know, for Adivasi and Dalit girls, okay, because there have been instances of violence and organized sort of you know, sexual abuse rackets there, and even killings there, murders of young girls there, coming out from so many states now. Okay, there were reports emerging from Chhattisgarh, from many of these same areas, this part of Chhattisgarh, Bastar part of Chhattisgarh. But it isn't only Chhattisgarh. Similar reports have emerged from Maharashtra and recently in Bihar, where it's a very different kind. As I said, it's a secular government there that says we are not like the BJP and all of that. But over there also, quite recently, there was a young Dalit girl, the daughter of an agricultural laborer, who is herself not educated, but she was very determined that her daughter should go to school. And she sent her daughter to stay in the hostel and study. And over there, you know, the same thing, that the hostels claim to have this entire architecture of, you know, restrictions in the name of safety. All that is there. But at the same time, you actually have a lot of systematic violence going on in there. And this young girl had called her, you know, had called her mother, had made a phone call to her mother from somebody's phone to say, come and get me. And the mother came and said, why do you want to leave school? What's wrong? And she said, if you take me home, I'm not feeling well. And she said, you know, tell me what's wrong, what's, you know, and then I'll think about it. And then she eventually told her mother that there was a teacher who was asking for sexual favors and offering me better marks in return, and I'm afraid as a result. And so her mother didn't know what to do, but she thought, well, let me at least take her out and then think about it. So she gave some other excuse to the school. She said, you know, I'll give her some maths tuitions. There are exams coming up, so I'll just take her home for a little bit. And they didn't allow her to do that. They must have, you know, the authorities probably guessed what was happening, because they, you know, physically flung this mother out of the school, threw her bag out, you know, threw her bag across the room, didn't allow her, you know, the bag had food for her daughter. They didn't allow her to give her that. And they told her, go home. And her mother, daughter called her again in the evening, you know, and they spoke. But the next morning, the daughter was found killed, murdered. All right. And there's been, you know, it's been almost a month now. It happened in early January, January 6th, I think. So it's a month now, and no one has been arrested. No action has been taken against the school authorities. This happened on their watch. And this is an incident where there have been very powerful struggles there, including by the schoolgirls in that school, very assertive and, you know, fighting really brilliant struggles there. But, you know, you get very little media attention also for those struggles and all of that. So it's not been good. So I think the contrast between this whole, you know, if Beti Padhao were to really mean a serious look at how our schools function, you know, making schooling available is not only in terms of course, it should mean addressing the question of making, it links up with what I was asked in the beginning about the demands that feminists make, right? The demands that we would be making would be, of course, to make sure that affordable, good quality education is available to all children in India, and especially to all girls. And that that your schools everywhere should be, you know, you should have some kind of oversight in your schools to make schools and hostels to make sure that girls find, you know, that the students can find it, not only girls, I mean, schools, that students should find it safe to be able to report any kind of violence or any kind of, you know, any kind of duress, any kind of coercion, any kind of abuse. That is completely not there. To say anything in Indian schools, I mean, it's such a power hierarchy there. To say anything is to risk being thrown out, especially if you are from a oppressed class or caste, or if you're a girl. So changing that would be very much a demand we'd be making. But the government is not interested in addressing any of that as part of its Beti Padhao, you know, educate daughters campaign. And it's not even willing to acknowledge the need for education about sexual violence in schools. It happens in some schools, but very selected schools. There is no, you know, largely it's a, there is this whole thing like sex education is a bad thing. You shouldn't do it. It's going to promote promiscuity and this and that. The idea that you have to actually educate about sexual violence and sexual abuse among children is not accepted, you know, largely by the Indian government. And yeah, I was asked about Rajasthan and those figures. I haven't closely studied the Rajasthan figures, so I'm not absolutely certain. But I know from activists in Rajasthan that I've been in touch with and worked with, who say very clearly that, you know, so I can't quote the actual figures now and say, you know, what the thing is. But they've said that actually the implementation of, you know, the PCP and DT law there, the law that bans sex determination is actually, it's actually been very bad. It's actually been one of the worst states and so on. And of course, there have been efforts and initiatives by women's groups there to do this kind of thing, including to do sting operations and expose doctors who are, you know, so to send women as decoys, saying we're pregnant and seeing whether doctors are going to tell them. So actually, women's groups have done a lot of this. The government being invested in this or really interested in this, I think not at all. In fact, the Rajasthan government and the Vasundhara Raje government has been particularly hostile to, you know, even the idea of accepting that, you know, such forms of violence against women are a bad thing, all right? So it's been a government that has been quite famously, you know, openly sexist and very, very resistant to any kind of change there and any kind of response there. So I don't think I would rely very much on that. I'll take a look at the story that you mentioned. I'll look for that and, you know, look at the figures that are being talked about. Yeah, but I'm not sure. See, again, when I say figures, no, I don't know what those figures are, because as I said, I mean, your actual sex ratio figures are quite old. I mean, you can't really have very fresh figures right now. So, yeah, so the fresh figures would be, you know, how, where are those coming from? No, because those are not reliable. The figures which one should look at, and I don't know if they had those, is about how many cases are registered actually against doctors, you know, and against, if it's widespread, then you should have a lot of cases being reported. Yeah.